Hi, we're back with another sneaky bonus episode, which is, I think, 3 weeks late.
Yeah, maybe. It took so long to recover from fucking top loader, that's why.
Or based on our usual standards, this is about 6 weeks early. But this is Sound as a Pound.
Sound as a Pound, and this is the episode where we go to Poundland and buy a record and talk about it for a few minutes.
I forgot the record. It's at home. I didn't actually bring the CD with me. I bought a CD and then didn't bring it with me.
Have you actually listened to the CD?
No, I haven't listened to the CD. Yeah. It's sitting in cellophane wrapper in my flat. Completely. That's a wasted pound, really, isn't it?
Do you think
I used to have that album as well and then donated all my CDs to Oxfam and then now fucking rebuying CDs that I used to have.
But, I mean,
it's probably the same one.
This is the thing, right? So I was going to say, do you think... I know it was wrapped, right? So the top loader one I got wasn't wrapped.
Was it not?
No.
Mine was wrapped as well.
I'm curious as to whether anybody ever listened to the CD you got or whether what you guys are picking up are albums so fucking banal and ubiquitous that people are getting them and not even bothering opening them and just fucking...
returning them.
Or getting like four copies of it for their Christmas because they're such a fucking munt that they just get sent the same
thing. Top loader, just accuse the two of us of being banal and ubiquitous. Absolutely... fuck off.
can we just take a wee second to ask which one of the group here got an email about Top Loader's 20th anniversary for August like Mocha?
Are you putting them on? Yeah. Are you putting them on?
Yeah, okay. So yeah, maybe I might have been sent an email asking about
was the email sent to you or did you email them and then get the press release sent back to you?
No, sincerely, the email was sent to me.
Okay.
Unsolicited email from Top Loader's agent.
But I got a fucking offer of R. Kelly last week.
Ooh. Did you?
Yeah.
Holy
still
shit.
Looking for gigs.
Put them on together.
How much to look for?
I didn't fucking reply.
You know what we could do, right? We did Judgment Night as part of the movie one. We could start a soundtrack to a film which is like obscenely crap indie rock bands with shamed rappers. So we could
Talking about shame drappers, we're actually, I don't know when the split 7-inch is going out, but that's going to be kind of part of it.
Yeah, so if you're
not, R. Kelly could feature in that split 7-inch.
If you're not a member already, you should definitely sign up to unsungpod.net/donate and give us a wee bit of cash so you can get this sweet split 7 that's coming in the next couple of weeks. But Dave's right. I think you, as a book at Chris, you as a book at one venue, and Dave, you as a book at another venue, so book both of those together and see what happens.
My lord.
Co-pro. We co-pro our way out of every invitation ever.
R. Kelly, supported by Top Loader.
Co-pro our way into ostracism.
That's a better lineup than Transmit, so. Fucking is.
What is that girl? Is it Queen Tuts? Is that the thing that's happening?
Queen Tuts. Yep. Oh. Progressive as ever.
Yeah, finally, ladies, equality.
Yeah, you've got a whole stage for you. Why don't you just put them across the whole fucking bill instead of putting them on their own, like one stage? It's ridiculous.
No, we should keep.
You don't put women straight away.
You segregate them.
Yeah, exactly. That's what they are. So I love that every single person that came to Transmit's defense and was like, oh, they're trying to be like, blah, 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 was a man. Unbelievable. Like the self-awareness.
What
is
I'm
a
really
joke.
Looking forward to is when they continue this theme and next year they have a black stage.
Yeah, exactly. I know.
Headline by R. Kelly. No.
Top loader headline in the white stage. Brilliant. What a year it's going to be next year. 2020.
Is your friend, Dave, is your friend going to be part of the Top Loader 20th anniversary for Angus Big Mocha? Do you know?
I don't think so. He's too busy actually doing eating his them. Job, I think. Yeah. So.
Fair enough. Speaking of friends, I don't think this
is not a good record.
This guy.
Yeah, it's a pretty good record.
Is anybody friends with this guy?
What's he called? Destroy Scottish. Rock and Roll?
He's Scottish. Does anybody know this guy?
I have a few kind of medium links to him, and I've met his dad.
Medium, like as in psychic.
I've met his dad. He's a very nice man. I think I've met his brother as well.
How did you know you were meeting Milo's dad?
Just because his dad
cuts a bit saying, "Oh, by the way, I'm Milo's dad."
No, he's quite a well-known guy. he's like writes stuff. Yeah, quite a well-known guy on Sky.
On Sky. Sure, he's a local celebrity, right?
Hector.
And his brother's in a band, right?
Yeah, his brother's in a band.
Engines.
Who are actually really good. They released some weird stuff back in the day. And funnily enough, I featured the first time I became aware of Milo was before this record came out, and I was, I'd just left school, so I was 17, maybe 18, and I was living up in the Highlands because I took a year out to work in the call center and earn money.
I was going to say to go and stay in the woods.
No, I worked for O2.
The werewolves.
I worked for O2 in Alness to earn money to before I went to uni. I spent all of that money in the commercial hotel.
What did you do with it?
I went to uni with £600 in my bank account. All of the rest of it spent in the pub. But I did. There was some sort of Channel 4 Highlands and Islands thing up there that they spent money on for young people to get involved with music. And there was like 12 of us applied, or 12 people, a bunch of people applied, and the team was picked and I managed to get on it. And we basically made a compilation record of the best music coming from the Highlands. And it happened over like 6 months. And in the end, like, the CD actually went out on the cover of Music Week magazine. And we went to Meadem and Cannes, and it was all fucking industry wank. One of the artists that we got on it was Milo just before his album came out. And in fact, went to Meadem, launched the Music Week magazine on the same week as this album came out. And I remember going into this record shop in Cannes, and like these two total wank guys with suits were like picking up and going, "Oh, ooh, Milo is going to be very big." And I was like, "Aye, that's me. I'm putting that out. Hey, mate, fucking no, oh boy." And
I was going to chastise you for borderline racism. Then I remembered it's Cannes where everybody's racist anyways.
Yeah, exactly. And then I was racist against myself. So, but yeah, and Indians were also on that album.
So Milo had been putting stuff out though before that. This was sort of like almost a compilation of like singles and shit he'd been putting together for ages, isn't it?
No, he'd never really released anything.
But he had like a bunch of singles and stuff.
He had a bunch of singles after this album. This was like, he'd been at Oxford and done like a philosophy degree and then went to the States.
With a PhD in philosophy?
Yeah.
And then came back. To make music.
And basically went back to Sky, had a Apple Mac, and put together a bunch of drum loops, sounds, played some bass on it, and made this record.
It was some kind of like philosophical realization that fuck it, nothing matters. I might as well just churn out shit and get rich.
I don't really think this record's that shit.
It sounds like elevator music.
Like, some of it's really beige a little bit, but like some of it's pretty decent dance music.
It's like Playmobil dance music. It's like dance music but simmered down to like...
No, really, but some of it's like quite nice, warm, indie. It's like that sort of Royksopp sort of stuff. It came out in 2004, and it was around the time that a lot of like dance music big hitters like Chemical Brothers, Daft Punk, Fatboy Slim had all been huge and then released shit albums, and this came out and kind of had a bit of hype around it. Remember, like, it's got Destroy Rock and Roll on the front of it. It's got that like sort of spray painted thing. I mean, yeah, they spray painted that all around Glasgow. But
don't get me wrong, man, I actually don't begrudge the guy for having some like pretty basic sort of skills, but I think that's the thing. Like, this is his first record, which is remarkable,
and only record,
he did one with Mix Mag afterwards in 2009, Milo's Back or something like that.
Yeah, he also did a weird thing on YouTube quite recently where he released songs but nobody paid attention.
I mean, it's his first record and he's kind of like a self-made guy in that sense, so I'm not like trying to be too critical of the fact that his skills on it are pretty basic, but his skills on it are pretty basic, even though you're comparing it to like Royksopp and, you know, Groove Armada and stuff like that. It's like the actual production of it's much, much more...
It's quite drag and drop sort of stuff.
Yeah.
But some of the, you know, like when you go through it, the tunes are quite memorable. The samples are quite memorable. Like Drop the Pressure and In My Arms are both really good dance hits. You know, you can't get away.
Waiting for a Start to Fall by Boy Meets Girl is much, much better than Into My Arms.
Well, yeah, I don't know, maybe. That's where you belong, in my arms, baby, yeah. It doesn't improve on the original, but it's still a good track.
Can't improve on the original.
It's I like Muscle Cars. That's a good track. Like Valley of the Dolls and Sun Worship are kind of like those sort of nice background music. Muscle Cars is a good tune. I like Paris 400 actually. Ricky's pretty cool. That's got like a total Daft Punk vibe.
I'll give you Paris 400 is the only track in it that was like, that's just quite good. Yeah, it's got like wee hints of like, you know, it's got wee hints that reminds me a little bit of White Town. Mm-hmm. And then it's got a slightly kind of nighttimey, crouty thing to it. It's the only one that actually was like, ah, oh, yeah, I can.
And then Destroy Rock and Roll was like the one that got him kind of big. That was the one that just had that man sampling bands that should go to hell.
This didn't destroy rock and roll. This album,
no, but it was a fine record. Like I don't think it's a shit album. It got a lot bigger than anybody thought it would because it's quite inoffensive, but it's got some good tracks on it.
Do you think guys, like, what's his actual name as well?
Miles McInnes.
Do you think Miles did this record because he had like this unquenchable inner kind of thirst to express himself artistically, or do you think he just did it because he could do it?
I think he did this record because he was just sitting at home and he was like, oh, I'll make this record. And then he put it out and it started to get traction. And then all of a sudden it was like one of the biggest selling records of the year. And then he's never put anything out afterwards because he's never pretended to be some sort of tortured artist who needs to put music out. He just put out an album that made him a lot of money unexpectedly. And he's like, well, that was nice.
I kind of feel like he just was like, fucking hell, I got away with that one. I'm not going to chance that again.
Yeah. Possibly. I mean, that's fine, right?
He played about with some samples at home and then it made him £1 million. So, you know, pretty good. If any of the three of us had done it, we wouldn't have returned the money, you know.
Just I'm going to send this money back. Yeah, I feel as though I've ripped the people off.
Exactly.
Here.
I promised Mark I'd keep my analogies minimal this week. I thought it sounded a little bit like the in-game music from a deleted version of Grand Theft Auto, where you drive around Falkirk Town Centre in a Vauxhall Nova throwing empty cans of hooch at moshers.
I've done that before.
I would play that game.
Or the tune that was playing at your second cousin Chelsea's wedding when she found out her sister's actually her mum.
How did you ever meet my second cousin Chelsea?
I don't know, man. I don't know. But I mean, okay, there's like little bits of like, when I was listening to it, I got bits of Air, I got bits of Daft Punk, I got bits of Groove Armada. None of whom are particularly like. Air will maybe let you off because they're okay, but not that much. And I'm just like, do we need more of this? Especially when it's like, actually devoid of a lot of the actual chops. I don't know how it got so big. It did.
Because it was
It wasn't particularly a huge song, man.
Yeah, it wasn't particularly challenging as an album. You could put it on and play it the whole way through and it would be nice, like on a nice summer's drive to the beach and you're all chatting, right? But then it's also got like the sort of viral hit Destroy Rock and Roll, which kind of got it big because people were like, oh, I haven't heard a man speaking on a track before. And then In My Arms and Drop the Pressure, because there was the Drop the Pressure remix, which got much, much bigger because it added in another 80 sample to it. I'd like those two tracks really hit it with the clubs. And so you had like dinner party music, you had young people being interested in music, and then you had club music. So it was like kind of all three. And then nobody hated it because there was nothing to hate about it apart from the fact that it wasn't particularly exciting.
We are breaking new ground here. Dinner party music.
I totally
fuck off, top loader.
Totally.
We're working within the Pound Shop, and this was a record that I actually liked from the Pound Shop.
I mean, I'm pretty sure there was a lot of coke done off the back of your CD as well. You should definitely open
and
find out.
That's probably true. Yeah, give that a wee taste. It'll be a bit salty.
This is dance music dumbed down for folk that were struggling to follow dance music.
No, it's not. It's dance music for people that don't listen to dance music and like the radio.
It's dance music.
Dinner parties.
It's dance. Totally, yeah. Yeah, it's like an introduction to dance music, which is fine because introduced some people to dance music. I'm sure there's some people down at the fucking sub club in a mad fucking techno taking loads of eckies who bought this album 15 years ago.
Oh, look where it got them.
Yeah, exactly.
I bet Calvin Harris owns this record.
Oh, Calvin Harris was majorly influenced by this because, like, he only came out like 3 years after and then he basically had that, the same track, you know, with samples over the top of it.
Fuck, I'm a fucking loser for the Western Isles. I could make some shite music.
He's actually from Dumfries.
Is he?
Yeah.
He's also fucking huge now. So
he's also highest paid musician of the, like, over the last 5 years.
I like the use of the word musician there. That's generous.
Oh. He's also physically massive. Like, he would definitely eat you, I think.
He seems like a nice man, but
he does seem like a nice man. Yeah.
Oh, his fucking music's bogging.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah,
this is better than Calvin Harris.
So, I would agree with that, yeah.
So this introduced Idiots to dance music. Can we introduce this to the bin?
David, was it worth a pound?
It was worth a pound.
Okay. Fucking I bought no it before. Way, man.
If Dave thinks it's worth a pound, then it's worth a pound.
I think it's worth a pound.
Sound is a pound.
All right, well, we'll be back next week or the week after or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
4 weeks' time.
Yeah. I'll be doing one in the near future.
Yeah, oh, it's wonderful.
It is actually a good album.